want to just sort of sneak up so you don't sprinkle any dirt down the bottom of this place where we turned it over.
Yeah, okay.
Look at that soil. It's all cake looking in
there. Yeah, it is.
Where are we?
Look up yonder. To the left.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Let me get the soil before you start whacking, okay?
Oh, yeah.
It's all glass covered.
Here, we can see evidence of the mining. Now, this mine closed many years ago.
The bottom is glass covered, Houston.
Yeah, white glass.
So if we look into the quarry in the normal daylight, in the absence of the snow, it would look a bit like a lunar landscape.
No, that's the black stuff is the glass. That's other's crystal. That's the crystalline rock.
Now, I say that for one specific reason, because during the Apollo program, the astronauts, they came back from the moon with bucket loads and bucket loads of moon rock and dust.
Oh, that part of it is. Very good.
And upon analysis, they were really, really surprised to find that there were a number of elements, including yttrium, which existed in a much, much higher abundance on the moon.
Which happens to be the deepest penetration that boulder made.
So we're in Ytterby in Sweden, and it's a really nice day, and we've come to the Ytterby quarry, or Ytterby gruva, which is actually the birthplace for four of the elements. And really, the one we're going to talk about now is this one here, yttrium. It was first discovered in this quarry from a really horrible black lump of mineral, which people thought was coal. And over a period of about 40 years, from the late 1700s on, some scientists over in Arbo did a lot of work in refining this material, and they found a new earth, or yttria. Okay, this is yttrium and oxygen, and they couldn't get the oxygen out by using traditional reductive methods, so metal making methods like burning with carbon and charcoal. So the yttria survived, and it was known for about 40 years before the German scientist Wöhler decided to react the yttria with much more reactive element, potassium. The potassium wrestled and ripped out the oxygen, and he made yttrium metal for the first time. Yttrium, it's used in a whole range of different things. It's used in semiconductors with this yttrium barium copper oxides, the 1-2-3 complexes as we know of, and it's used for a whole range of different applications. It's used in laser technologies to make very intense pulses of light for technologies like CDs and LEDs, etc., etc., but massive area. Another activity, or another use for yttrium, is actually in the use of yttrium oxysulfide, which is used as an additive in glass. It makes glass really tough, like bulletproof glass. It makes it shock resistant and very, very, very resistant towards temperature changes. So it's a very useful additive in glasses and glassy materials. Make sure you don't fall over the rock. So yttrium itself is a really quite nice, lustrous, soft metal from group 3 of the periodic table. It burns really readily in an oxygen-rich atmosphere and reacts quite well with water in the atmosphere as well. So you have to be very careful with yttrium because it oxidizes and it's really quite easy to destroy.
That's yttrium metal, just as turnings. So we have to handle this under nitrogen because generally it'll form an oxide layer and then you won't be able to do any chemistry with it.
Yttrium is an element which is not, again, particularly widely studied in chemistry, much less so than its neighbour zirconium. And it's, but again, it's an area where chemists now are beginning to focus on rather more.
If it's really finely divided, then it might burst into flames. In fact, all metals, if they're very finely divided, they're quite likely to spontaneously combust.